Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Genesis Blog Podcast. Today we have for you another guest interview. And with us today is Vokkant from Woodstock. He's a research associate looking at primarily gaming and infrastructure projects. But I'll hand it over to him to introduce himself.
Hey guys, happy to be here. So as I mentioned, I'm Vokkant. I've been with Woodstock for close to 2 years now, and I've spent like around 3 years in the Web3 space. So before this, I was primarily more involved on the technical side. I used to be a smart contract dev, and I went on with Microsoft before I joined Woodstock full time. And now I've been here for almost 2 years. Again, my sectors primarily include infrastructure, Web3 infrastructure, L1s, L2s. That is my primary, the primary thing that I'm interested in. And also a little bit of gaming projects on the side. Happy to be here. And
Awesome. Thanks for that. Before we get into specifics, would love to just learn a little bit about yourself and Woodstock. I mean, obviously, as much as you're comfortable with sharing, but, you know, how did you get into crypto, and what is Woodstock's niche, if there is any? And, you know, what is their core thesis playing in this space, in this nascent space?
So my journey actually started out with I was interning somewhere, and I was given a project. I had to choose between a ML-related project and a blockchain-related project. And I just thought blockchain is more of a niche skill, so I thought I'll acquire that now and see how it goes. And after that, when I got into it, you know, it was a rabbit hole. I just fell in love with the space. And after that, I've, never looked back, never looked at anything else also, to be very honest. I've just been on that path. So yeah, as I mentioned earlier, I started out as a smart contract developer, took part in a few hackathons, and got into the exercise of writing smart contracts, which was a lot of fun and very engaging. And I think the main value that I could feel there was, you know, writing code that would handle like millions of dollars worth of transaction volume and general, like, which is why it requires a lot of like, you know, good coding practices, a lot of safety that needs to be taken into account. So that part of it I found very exciting, which is why I decided to, you know, dive deeper into the space. On Woodstock's front again, so Woodstock is one of India's oldest and largest crypto native venture capital fund. We started out in 2019, and we have investments all across the Web3 stack. So they range from L1s, L2s, infrastructure plays, DeFi projects, NFTs, and gaming, all across the stack. We on the thesis side of it, so we have published our thesis recently, and you can look into it. But on a very high level, our thesis basically focuses on three parts: convergence, financialization, and virtualization. So the idea is that with blockchain and with crypto coming into the picture, there will be a convergence of technology, there will be a convergence of cultures, which will lead to a lot of, you know, like distributed teams coming together and building products for a wider, for a global audience. With financialization, we expect that decentralized finance will, and some, there will obviously be some regulation that will have to come into DeFi. And, you know, that has become very clear with the recent, like, sort of events with FTX that have happened. But some sort of regulation will have to come into the space. But eventually, decentralized finance will create a lot of liquidity and allow users to participate in sophisticated financial products directly in a more comfortable and open manner. And with virtualization, again, we see that trend of, you know, companies investing into the metaverse and slowly product being built out for the retail users, where they are in charge of their own data, they are in charge of their own assets. And we think that blockchain will play a very foundational role in the virtualization aspect of things. So that is our thesis on a very high level, obviously. Yeah, you can deep dive into it further if you go to our website.
Yeah. No, I know for a fact Sid is waiting to go a bit deeper on few of those points, but I'll just ask you one last thing before that, about your background, right? So at a functional level, at a crypto VC, what exactly does a research associate do?
So I would say my time is spent mostly like on two main tasks. One of them is evaluating deals. So again, this is looking at, you know, particular deal flow that we have received. So analyzing different projects, seeing what valuation they're raising at, whether those valuations are sustainable, what we think of the product market fit of a particular product, how and how we evaluate it, right? So there are the metrics that we like to follow, we call the 5D metrics. And after that, we also have, so yeah, I think that is the first part of my job, which is analyzing deal flow. Some part of it is obviously, you know, goes into sourcing deals, talking to people, trying to figure out who's building what in the ecosystem, looking at different accelerators, hackathons, seeing what kind of projects are coming out there. And another significant chunk of it is just like researching the space in general. So seeing what sort of movements we're seeing on chain, what, you know, ecosystems are picking up, what sort of products we envision will be successful in the next upcoming wave of, like, you know, the bull market, or what wave will find product market fit next. So, yeah, I think the time is like majorly distributed across these two activities. Then I also work on the technology side of things. So I have some like level of coding that I have to do for internal tracking that we do for some of our portfolio companies, say, or, you know, working with our portfolio companies in general and trying to help them out with their architecture, their code base, and anything on those lines as well.
Got it. Awesome stuff. Very interesting. So I'll hand it over to you.
Yep, just one. No, I mean, it's not, I'm not going to start with like some insane questions or anything, but just about Woodstock in general, do you guys do only token deals, or is it token plus equity as well? Or like, what would you prefer?
Yeah, so I think that what everyone prefers answer changes drastically from a bear market to a bull market. So in the bull market, I think everyone wants to invest into tokens. In the bear market, obviously, everyone's a lot more conservative and they prefer equity for, you know, like its stability and the long-term gains that are possible there. So with regards to, sorry, what was the first part of your question?
No, is it just like, would you prefer, or do you guys prefer token investments or token plus equity or mostly equity? Like, what is the mix that's the sweet spot?
So we don't have a defined like ratio or anything like that. I think we're favorable to both token and equity investments. For us, I think it's about if we are going ahead with a token model, it should make sense. Like, I think that is the primary concern that we have. So any project that we're talking to that has a token, we have an in-house tokenomics team that actually works very closely with our portfolio companies to help them design their tokenomics. And that's also how like a key point of evaluation of seeing whether a token sort of makes sense with this product. If it doesn't, we're more than happy. If we do like the product, we're more than happy to go into equity deals and make equity investments as well, obviously. So that is not a bar for us in any way. We do both token and equity. Just like what makes sense to us is what
okay, cool. And then from the tokenomics perspective, when you you say that you guys have a team that you know, assesses the tokenomics, helps teams define the tokenomics, et cetera, et cetera. What do you think the bar is to have a token? Like, and what I mean by that is, in my opinion, there's always like a bit of a bar to cross that kind of proves, you know, okay, this is a definite use case or a necessity for a token for this project or for this, you know, ecosystem. So obviously it can vary from project to project, but from a higher level, what do you think is the level of scrutiny that a project needs to do in order to understand, you know, whether a token is absolutely necessary for the products or services that it's delivering? Because we've seen a lot of issues with user friction, and obviously a lot of, you know, a lot of times where people just haven't understood tokenomic models or like even designed them properly. So in your opinion, you know, what are the kinds of things that what essentially is the bar for having a token, and what do you think are the most important things that people really slip up on when they're designing these things?
Perfect. And that's a great question. I think what a lot of founders miss sometimes is, you know, actually figuring out why that token sort of dynamic is necessary. And, you know, very often you would run into like sort of B2B, you know, SaaS applications that would want to do a token, which again, doesn't really make sense because their primary customer base will not want to engage with the token. Their user base, again, is not, you know, you're not marketing to a retail user base. So, which is where that token sort of argument really like falls apart. So I think on some level, I don't even think that governance in itself is a good enough. And again, these are my personal views. I wouldn't say these are the wider like tokenomics team's views or Woodstock's views in general. But my view is that, you know, like even governance in itself is not enough, a good enough utility to, you know, justify having your own token out there. So I think in protocols that require some level of decentralization, where there is some, you know, dependency on other people to act in a, like, in a socio crypto way in the right manner, I think that is where tokens become really, really critical. So again, for an L1, for example, and to, you know, coordinate the base like transaction layer and make sure that transactions are added to the ledger appropriately, I think that is where a token model makes a lot of sense. I think for particular like infrastructure plays as well, it makes a lot of sense to have a token, because you need that for the internal coordination of the protocol, and you need it to, you know, like penalize sort of malicious players as well if they say, you know, serve the wrong data or something like that. Depends on what sort of infrastructure protocol we're talking about. So I think those are use cases where it makes a lot of sense. On the gaming side, I would say there are some, so I know that, you know, crypto gaming recently has been obsessed with creating, like, you know, these deflationary tokens that manage to accrue value from the gameplay itself. I still don't see that sort of a vision working very well. You know, I have, like, obviously I have much, like, more deeper views on how the crypto gaming space sort of should play out and what sort of token models we see there. But yeah, I think currently that is not in its, like, not in its best format, because what it does is it creates, even if you have a token that rapidly does, like, sort of accrue value to itself, it prices out a lot of the users who are trying to play the game, which in itself is sort of counterproductive to what is happening. So yeah, I think on a very high level, yeah, those are my views, but happy to, you know, go into the details, talk about like specific projects and tokens which I think work and what doesn't work in some way.
No, I think that makes sense.
Are there any particular instances that you've seen that you don't think a token is needed, where, you know, the team is of a contrary point of view?
Yeah, so that does happen, but I think internally it's more about, you know, talking to those teams, justifying our reasons for why we don't think a token is necessary here, right? Like for the B2B SaaS example that I just gave, I think that is one of the conversations we even have had with a few portfolio companies, where if you're trying to build that sort of a product which appeals to institutional investors, appeals to institutions who will primarily be engaging with that product, they won't have space on their balance sheet to hold your token to, you know, gain access to certain features. And this makes the product very intimidating and actually not usable for them. So say if that institution that you're trying to onboard is, you know, headquartered in the US or is registered in the US, then that in itself limits them from holding a lot of tokens on their balance sheet. So that in itself becomes an issue. So I think those sort of problems need to be dealt with in the right way. Sometimes, you know, again, you can come to like a middle ground as well, where some part of it can be funded by the token, but you also make sure that, you know, so again, like the way that a lot of infrastructure protocols operate is, instead of, you know, making the customers or the institutions pay in the native currency of that particular protocol, you pay in stable coins, and then on the back end that is converted into the token. So that also becomes another interesting model that you can offer up as a solution if a token is necessary. So if someone is decentralizing their backend, for example, I think a token becomes very necessary there. So then you need to sort of combine that institutional angle with the general tokenomics of, you know, having a distributed infrastructure pattern or a distributed L1 sort of system. So yeah, I think it really varies, I think, case to case, but these are definitely discussions that we have internally.
I found the stablecoin point extremely interesting, because that's kind of, you know, like when I mentioned what is the bar, for me, when I'm trying to understand how to design tokenomics, my bar, and like it's a bit crude at the moment, but you know, the bar that I hold tokens to is, could I replace this with a stablecoin and will it be easier? That's one of the things that I look at as, you know, a kind of barometer to understand whether there's tokens, whether a token is actually necessary to either bootstrap the protocol or bootstrap incentives between stakeholders within that protocol. So in terms of stablecoins, right? So what do you think about the use of stablecoins within a token economy for a project, or like for a protocol? Like, where do you think they should come in, and where do you think there's a necessity for a token, for a native token to be there instead of stablecoins? Like, you know, if you've got any examples from your experience, or, you know, even if you don't, just like what your opinions are on that.
Yeah, so I think the token is necessary. I mean, I think on an ideal level, we could all say that, you know, say if there's a certain infrastructure protocol that requires that instead of, you know, using the native token that they have created, you can always replace it with a stable coin and use stable coin for payments and for coordination in the network. Have, you know, every sort of node provider sort of run their own, I mean, you know, provide their own stake in stable coins, which can be slashed if they behave maliciously or something on that front. But the only argument I have against that is, so for that, a protocol needs to generate actual and real revenue, which is something that all Web3 protocols in the beginning struggle with. So what a token does is it provides them with a good way to bootstrap the network initially in the form of incentives. So the way that, say, you know, Pocket Network, for instance, use their token to just bootstrap and get a lot of node providers, a lot of like RPC relayers onto the network so that they can service whatever demand exists. Now, again, there can be, you know, some disparity in the demand supply as well, which ended up happening in case of Pocket as well, where there were too many node providers and not enough people actually requesting for those services, and the token basically inflated out of control and wasn't sustainable anymore. But I think that gets to the finer details of it. But I think as a bootstrapping mechanism, it is very, very necessary in some places. So again, because even like, say, Ethereum in its current form generates significant revenue, right? For its validators, where validating on the network can actually be profitable. Now, there's a whole technical argument here as well as to why that coordination layer is necessary, because if you just fund a protocol via the transaction fees, it leads to this thing called block instability, but that is a more technical discussion. From a purely economic perspective also, there will be like early days in the Bitcoin, and in fact, even in the Bitcoin network right now, if you look at periods where we go through a bear market, most of the transaction fees is actually funded by the inflation of the protocol itself and not by the actual revenue that is being generated from different transactions. So to ensure that security in the network, to ensure that, you know, hash power in the network stays above a certain level where it is safe, I think that those tokens are necessary for that sort of social coordination.
So I know you said it's a bit technical, but do you want to just quickly touch upon the block instability aspect of this a little bit, because I like delving a little bit into the technical aspects, and that seems interesting.
Yeah. So block instability is a problem that has been discussed for quite some time. And there was this whole wave of like academia in, you know, 2013 to 2017 that came in and said, you know, Bitcoin is instable for X, Y, Z reasons. And a lot of that has to obviously do, a lot of that has to do with game theory, but obviously, you know, game theory assumes that everyone is operating to, you know, generate the maximum profit, which can vary from certain cases. So there's a very famous quote by Hasu, who's a very famous like researcher, who says that, you know, that Bitcoin is insecure in theory, but secure in practice. And one of those like sort of arguments against Bitcoin was that of block instability. So the idea there is that once you have, so I mean, currently, you know, we get 6.25 BTC for every block that is mined. And that is essentially inflation in the protocol. It's called block reward. Now, the idea is that when Bitcoin hits a certain block height, that inflation reward is going to keep halving, right? The Bitcoin halving thing. And eventually it's going to go down to zero. So there comes a point where once the block reward is zero, every needs to be funded by the transaction fees within that block, right? And the transaction fees themselves need to make it sustainable enough for so there will be a point where transaction fees are the only thing that incentivize validators to mine, or for miners to mine on the network, right? Sorry for getting a little confused with POS and POW there, but once you hit that point, what ends up happening is so right now, for every miner to be profitable, it makes a lot of sense to just keep adding new blocks to the blockchain, because you're getting a block reward which is more than the transaction fees of that block. But once that block reward goes away, the miner strategy deviates a little bit. So instead of mining new blocks continuously, it might be more profitable for a miner to fork the. So let's say there are two transactions in the Bitcoin blockchain right now. One has 1 BTC of fees and the other one has 3 BTC of fees, right? And a miner just like mines the block with the 3 BTC of fees. Now, if I'm a different miner looking at that new reward of just 1 BTC and I'm like, you know what, this isn't enough. Let me mine another block. So let me fork the chain and mine another block which includes that 3 BTC transaction as well, 3 BTC fee transaction. So what that essentially does is it forks the chain. So that leads to repetitive forking of the chain, which inherently makes the whole chain insecure, right? Because now different hash power is going into securing different like sort of chains of the Bitcoin blockchain. So that becomes one malicious strategy. Then there's another malicious strategy, which is to just wait for the high value transactions to show up, which can again create a significant lag in between two blocks showing up, which slows down the entire network. So there are a total of like some six different deviant strategies that can take place, and which is why it's called block instability. And this is supposed to kick in at some point when inflationary rewards essentially run out, and we don't have enough transaction fees on the network to compensate for all of that.
So can this happen for all types of networks? Like in the sense that even for Ethereum, is it an even bigger threat now that Ethereum, the base fee gets burnt, right? For each block, and also that Ethereum is essentially trending towards deflation right now, right?
So that's why Ethereum is extremely smart, and you have to admire the genius for it, right? So with EIP-1559, what they do is they focus on, they ensure, and if you look at Vitalik's notes, so what I was saying is that Ethereum has 2 ETH constant inflation with every block. So the block reward always remains. So which is like this deviant miner strategies don't exactly exist, because it is always profitable for the miner to create a new block in the chain, right? So every new block that is mined on the chain, that miner will get, now validator, will get a certain, actually now it's not even 2 ETH anymore. 2 ETH was when it was POW. Now there's a certain inflation that has been decided, baked into the protocol, and the rewards take place based on that inflation curve, based on the value stake. But point is, you're constantly getting rewards for mining a new block. However, the deviant miner strategies don't exactly exist anymore, because the block reward is still there. Now, in order to prevent that continuous inflation of 2 ETH throughout each life cycle, they found that a better mechanism was to burn the base fees, which actually represents how many users are actually using the network and how many are using it to transact, and that value essentially gets burned. So it's a much smarter way of dealing with the block instability problem, and it's part of the reason why EIP-1559 was designed the way that it was. So yeah, you have to appreciate like its genius in this case for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, cool. I think that makes sense. Sorry, Sid, go on.
Just one last question on this point. Right. So what I'm trying to get at is there are two camps essentially, right? Of people who think that after the mining rewards go to zero, one side say that the transaction fees will not be enough to maintain the security and stability of the network, because miners, either won't want to participate or they will be incentivized to perform these malicious behaviors, right? And undermine the whole blockchain. Are you in that camp, or are you of the camp that believes, for whatever reason, that the transaction fees will be enough to justify good miner behavior?
So I think it's really hard to predict how it will work, but I'm actually a different camp, I would say like a third camp, where I definitely don't think that the transaction fees will be enough to compensate the network, because the way that Bitcoin's narrative has been changing, right, and it's going more towards that sort of digital gold, high value transactions, there won't be a lot of velocity of Bitcoin. So the transaction fees on the network will be relatively low. And if you look at the user charts in a bear market, Bitcoin usage is close to like 0% in that transaction fee department. So I don't think that part will make up for it. I think there's an argument that can be made that most miners will not deviate to the malicious strategies to make the most amount of profits. Because if the Bitcoin blockchain itself becomes unstable, their assets and whatever they earn, essentially they're undermining themselves, right? So I think that creates that loop for them only to make sure that their chain is secure, which is why I don't think miners will go to those deviant.
You were saying that there's this third camp that the fact that the miners already have so much vested interest in the network, they won't perform these malicious activities. Is that essentially the case you're making?
Yeah. I don't think the transaction fees will be enough to incentivize the miners, but I think the fact that their underlying holdings and their underlying assets depend on this to succeed, that's why they will sort of tend to secure the network in the proper manner.
Sure, got it. Interesting. Okay, let's Let's switch it up a bit. So is there anything particular you want to ask, or should I go from there?
Yeah, I think like in terms of let's just go over like the general market right now then. So you know, in general, what is the impact of this year been? You know, from a VC perspective. So obviously, it's been a brilliant car crash of a year for crypto, where with you know, Luna and 3AC, Celsius, and you know, the mother of all frauds, FTX happening this year, Voyager. I mean, all of them are connected, right? The amount of correlation in this space is actually mind blowing. But you know, like, what has the impact been? You know, from both a capital deployment perspective, and from an LP interest perspective. So you know, your LPs, like, what is their reactions? What are their reactions been? You know, what about any other outside interest that you've been getting? What about the general sentiment that you've been seeing about crypto from investors, and also from, you know, regular you know, any other people that you think are important? You just wanted to get your take on, you know, this, just what's happened this year.
Yeah. So I think at the beginning of the cycle, when, you know, like, valuations were falling down, generally speaking, I think all of us were a little relieved, because end of last year, beginning of this year, we could see that the market was extremely hot and everything did feel like it was overvalued. And you could tell that, you know, all of it is going to come crashing down in some way. So when the first few, like, sort of corrections were happening, we thought that this would be healthy for the market. But then obviously, you know, like, a lot of incidents happened, FTX, Luna, all of that. And the contagion that came from all of that really, like, ruined things for everyone. So, and now, you know, we can't make that argument of saying that it is healthy for the market and that it is, you know, pricing things in the correct manner. Because unfortunately, it isn't. And it's, in fact, giving the, like, you know, ruining the reputation of the entire crypto space in general. So that part of it is extremely, extremely unfortunate. What on a investment, on the investment side of things, so again, I don't work with a lot on the fundraising side, so I can't speak to that with a lot of depth. I think, you know, my answers would be, like, fairly standard and generic, in the sense that, you know, there's a lot of distrust. We've seen Sequoia sort of, Sequoia LPs talk to their portfolio companies, talk to their partners and tell them that, you know, we don't want you guys to do any major crypto investments anymore, and so on and so forth. So it's not the best time, I think, definitely, to, you know, be associated with the space, unfortunately. I have lots of friends who've also reached out to me and been like, hey, so how's the scam industry you're working for going, and stuff like that, which is, you know, really, really unfortunate. From a capital deployment perspective, though, I would say things are a little bit exciting, because now you do see, you know, like, most of the projects we talk to are genuine builders. They're, you know, that they're here to stick around for the long term. There's also a lot less capital floating around anymore. So now, you know, due diligence is done more properly by all the other funds out there. We generally, you know, get more time to evaluate deals, because in the bull market, there used to be phases where, you know, everyone used to just FOMO into projects so heavily that you'd get a deal and you would have to close it within 1 week of getting it. Now due diligence periods are longer, so we can spend, like, you know, 2-3 weeks understanding every deal in depth, making sure that, you know, all the bases are covered, all the I's have been dotted and the T's have been crossed, and so on. So I think that part of it becomes very exciting, and we're definitely seeing a lot of interesting projects out there. So yeah, and we think that, you know, like, now is the now a new generation of, like, sort of these giga giant builders will step up and make sure that, you know, the space grows to the next level. So definitely excited for that part of it.
Sorry, go on. I just didn't want to cut you off.
No, I was just saying that, yeah, I think because, you know, if you have some capital lying around, now is definitely one of the better times to invest again. None of us can time the bottom perfectly. It's impossible to catch a falling knife. But you, you know, make sure that you're investing at this frame of time to make sure that you maximize your returns when you do get to a bull market.
Cool. And do you think, you know, just speaking about the froth of last year and you know, all the deal turnaround times and all of that, next time when it comes around, because there is going to be a bull and there's going to be a crash, and then the, you know, cycles repeat and history rhymes, you know. So do you think that it's kind of an indication that when people are going crazy and deals are coming in and you're just getting FOMO and you're missing out? I know that it's a bit of a haze at the time. But do you think that that's actually a sign that you have to step back a little bit and stick to your guns about your due diligence process, about you know, how you should be executing your deals based on your timelines as well, and not just giving into pressure because others are doing it as well. Is that just like sticking solidly to your principles a good way of navigating this kind of market?
Definitely. And I think that Woodstock, we have been trying to do that. Like, we, every intro call that we get onto, we, you know, definitely let the potential company know that we have at least like a 2 to 3 week due diligence process. So we're going to set up our business due diligence, we're going to set up our technical due diligence, you know, before we're in a position to commit. So we make those timelines generally very clear from the get-go. Now, what ends up happening is, even in the bull markets, even the good projects have like a significantly shorter timeline, right? Because the good projects do want, because it's much easier for them to raise capital. So I think it's a little interesting. I unfortunately don't have a direct answer for this about how you would, you know, like perfectly play that balance. But again, I would say for like 90% of projects, you definitely need to stick to your timelines. You need to stick to your DD. In some cases, which also I think would be true for this market, you need to take that leeway, make, you know, some bets purely based on how good, say, a particular founder is, or how good a particular product is and how it's shaping. So yeah, I think you need to like sort of assess what percentage. Again, those become like slightly higher risk deals. But again, we're in VC investing, right? So we're used to that level of risk, I think. So just like allocating what percentage you would like to, you know, give to like a founder's bet, allocating what kind of a percentage you would give to like a great product that's already live sort of a thing. And then, you know, like sticking to due diligence for the rest kind of helps navigate that framework and ensure that you don't have a significant downside when things go bad, I think. Yeah, I think that would be a better way to navigate it.
Okay, makes sense. Yeah, because I think that like the founder agreement, the founder argument is obviously the main thing, right? Like, you have to invest in founders. I think after FTX, that trust is definitely going to be shaken a little bit because people were holding SBF up as, you know, as one of the poster boys, as someone who was an absolute genius, as a founder you couldn't miss out on investing in, you know. So I think it'll be interesting to see how that mentality shift is going to affect investments over the next year or so, or even the longer time period, and what we're going to be learning from it. Because I think that as an industry, we've been scarred a little bit, because we've kind of been hoodwinked as other LPs, from, you know, within crypto native VC funds and also within non-crypto native VC funds who invest in this space. You are a bit scarred because, you know, I think that there had been a lack of due diligence, to be very honest, because a lot of what I've seen also came out and went like, you know, people were like, oh, he was on the cover of Forbes, obviously you're going to invest in him. And you go like, and then when all of this breaks, you go like, well, is that good enough due diligence? So I think that it's going to force people to do their DD a little more seriously. But these lessons get eroded with time. So I guess it also depends on the people who take them to heart and like continue, you know, sticking to your guns. And I think that I've learned a lot this year about what not to do.
Yeah, no, I think
definitely.
It was
also my first bull market, like pure bull run, and I saw like, you know, the euphoric phrase where everything you invest in just like 10x is the next day, and you feel like a genius one day, and you're like, wow, I'm so smart, I was made for this. And then you get to the bear market where, you know, everything you invest in just like doesn't really work out, and you start questioning the decisions that you made, and you're like, maybe I should have thought this through a little bit more. So
yeah,
definitely
yeah.
A lot of takeaways, but I kind of want to see how I react to the same cycle when it happens again, and
yeah,
whether
same.
Or not I'm able to learn from it.
Same, yeah.
Definitely, I think crypto, I mean, investing is very well known to be a battle of, you know, intellectual battle and emotional battle as well. I think crypto is probably at the, you know, the penultimate or ultimate point on that spectrum of, you know, where you can invest. So I think it's going to be quite interesting what we do in the next bull run. But just to conclude this conversation, wanted to get, you know, your personal views, and just, you know, looking into the future in the short to intermediate term, you know, what are some protocols that you're interested in? What are you, you know, personally excited by, especially right now when all the noise or most of the noise has, you know, disappeared?
So I think personally, I mean, I think this is the most like generic basic answer I can ever give you, but I think Ethereum definitely is, you know, something that I'm always looking forward to reading about their updates, seeing what they're doing, be it on any side, you know, like even like how they're doing with roll up abstraction, EIP 4844, and generally what they're trying to do to, you know, make sure that they have the execution capabilities that are required in the network, what they're doing on the data side of it with, like, you know, dance sharding and proto dance sharding and the various implementations of it. On the MEV side of it, you know, with like proposer builder separation and what sort of things are happening there. So I think Ethereum is definitely the most exciting ecosystem for me to look and read into as a pure, like, you know, person who looks at tech. I think Ethereum is definitely the most exciting protocol for me because, you know, the level of research and the fundamental understanding that they have in the space, a lot of other people lack. Other than that, I think from a core, like, sort of infrastructure perspective, I think I'm more looking into, say, RPC providers. And because if we do expect, you know, the demand for RPC to scale, if we do expect the users in crypto to scale significantly, I think RPCs have to scale along with that because they're essentially how you interact with the blockchain, right? So they're going to be used in the backend of every DeFi application. They're going to be used on the backend of every wallet. Everyone basically will need an RPC provider. So I think that if we expect the user numbers to, like, you know, continue to grow in an explosive manner, like we saw across the last couple of bull run, I definitely think RPC providers are a good place to, you know, sort of put your bets in, make sure, because that's an industry that's going to rise, keep increasing. With more institutional adoption, obviously, you know, we'll see some of the bigger RPC players also make significant revenue from those sort of chunks as well. Other than that, also really interested in oracles and sort of like these real world lending platforms. I think those have a good, I think those need to do really well for blockchain to find that like product market fit, because currently we're still stuck very much within the crypto ecosystem, right? Like you can exchange your crypto for crypto, but there's not a lot of applicability outside of it. So doing real world lending, like say with Goldfinch or Centrifuge, actually provides those real-world adoption use cases that everyone talks about. So you use oracles to, you know, provide real-world insurance and insure different types of products, do instant remittance. So those kinds of things, again, you know, make me really, really excited. And I think on the use cases side of it, I think those are the major ones. Gaming, I think, is still too nascent in current form. I don't see, like, particular Web3 games winning out against Web2 games directly very much in the future. I think that there's still, like, you know, scope for infrastructure bets there where once the base infrastructure is built out properly, once, you know, account abstraction happens properly so that users don't know they're interacting with the blockchain while playing the game, that is when I think we've achieved that goal of getting Web2 gamers onto Web3. Because currently, obviously, you know, they're not also big fans of it. So, I would say, like, on the gaming side of it, my bets would be more on the infrastructure side of things. I think on a very high level, those are the sectors that I'm like sort of deeply interested in and what I'm looking out for.
Just to push a little on the RPC point that you made, right? And we also alluded to you alluded to Pocket a bit early on. And those two, how do you reconcile the two? Because essentially they're contradictory points of views, right? Because if you're bullish on RPCs, Pocket should have ideally been a sound investment, but clearly we've seen that, as you mentioned, that the user side of it was not enough. So is it the case of Pocket was simply a bit too early?
No, I think in Pocket's case, the token model was the main issue. So because of the way that they had designed their token, it constantly inflated. And after a point, the token price fell drastically. The validators also, the node providers weren't compensated fairly enough. The users also had some. So again, I think, and I'm pretty sure Pocket itself is also working on, you know, redefining that tokenomics, coming up with a model that works. And when they have something that, you know, accurately balances that supply and demand, I think they'll be in a good place because they're truly one of the like most decentralized RPC plays out there. So definitely excited for Pocket, but I think with the current tokenomics, it doesn't work. I think that's how.
And what do you think about Infura getting more decentralized now? Because they've announced that, right? They've said that Infura is going to essentially decentralize its RPC nodes. I think that that's very bullish for the space. I actually think that consensus is doing a lot of good work for crypto in general. It is still pretty centralized, but if they're making an effort to decentralize and if they're, you know, they are core Ethereum. So what do you think that says about the space and, you know, just about, just in general, like how do you think they will decentralize? Like, what is the model they may use?
Sorry, my phones ran out of battery midway through. But so I Infura, I think. I mean, I think Infura's plans around decentralization. Yeah, I think Infura's plans around decentralization are sort of vague right now. We don't know exactly how they're planning to decentralize their RPC business. Even with MetaMask, I think everyone's... So they might take the token route because, again, with MetaMask launching swaps and everyone's now looking forward to the MetaMask airdrop as well, I think consensus has sort of, you know, taken that route where they do want to launch tokens for the different products that they operate on. So I think even Infura itself could have an Infura token and use that to, you know, coordinate the RPC part of it. And if they do that, I'm sure it'll be very well designed. And given that they have a strong user base already existing, I think for them to convert and be revenue positive and make sure the network is balanced should be fairly simple. So we'll see how that whole process, like, you know, sort of takes up. But unfortunately, yeah, we don't have a lot of details as to how they will be implementing or executing it as of now.
And just last question from me, because I know that we need to wrap up soon. But you mentioned the Oracle aspect of it. And I'm pretty interested in Oracles as well, because one of the use cases that I've always been bullish on, and honestly, it's one of the main reasons I came into the space, is tokenization of real world assets. And also, you know, the insurance stuff that you mentioned, et cetera, et cetera. But aren't Oracles one of the most important but also fragile infrastructural pieces of this ecosystem today, and how can they be made more robust? Like, for example, for some of the real world use cases that you've mentioned, right, or some of the real world use cases that it would be very useful for, especially for the tokenization of illiquid assets, there has to be a lot of reconciliation with off-chain processes in order to be able to effectively tokenize and service those assets on-chain. So in general, for things that are bespoke for illiquid assets and for even you know, illiquid real world assets that need to be tokenized, how can Oracles service those individual, you know, more bespoke assets? Because you would need, you know, trusted Oracles servicing data feeds for that individual asset that might be a little difficult to do. So how does that, like, there's a dream version where we have where all of this stuff gets tokenized and brought on chain, but then how does that, you know, match to reality where there are still, you know, lots of open questions around technically around how Oracles can do those things?
Yeah, so I think some parts of it are being worked on already. So like, for example, a lot of the lending that used to happen on Euler was done via the TVOP oracles that Uniswap used to provide, right? And again, because they were primarily taken from the Uniswap pool itself, it was fairly easy to manipulate that pool. And with the merge happening, there was also this concept of multi-block MEV that came around, mm-hmm. where you could use that TVAP or you could TVAP that oracle and manipulate it in a way so that you get a subprime loan via Euler. So what Euler did in response to that was to upgrade all of their price feeds from the Oracle TVOP to the Chainlink price feeds. So I think those sort of active measures need to constantly be taken to assess what is going on, what could potentially go wrong with your protocol with the upcoming changes, and figuring out what system works best. On a purely Oracle perspective, I think some of those issues will persist for some time, because again, a lot of these have to, you know, like, some of these issues might even be need to solve at the base layer. Because with Oracles, again, you have to, like, you know, have it. Everything gets updated in, say, two sets of transactions. Nothing happens atomically within one set. So I think that in itself creates some lag and creates some room for manipulation in that sense. So there are certain, like, problem statements that, and I would say some fairly open problem statements that need to be fixed in the Oracle world. But I think people are already working on that. And again, Chainlink is one of the biggest players. They've been leading the research for this for many, many years. And I know a lot of people are a lot smarter than me are working on it. So I'm sure we'll have a solution eventually, but yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a direct answer right now, but I think the problems that you pointed out are very fair. Some of them are being worked on right now. Some of them will obviously, you know, take more time to be implemented and to get through, but I think they will eventually, like, on a protocol level, they can be solved. They can be solved via different, like, sort of. So Chainlink is also working on their own cross-chain protocol as well. I think it's called CCIP or something. So that in itself might solve the you know, like all the bridging issues that we've seen everywhere. So again, there's like different sub solutions out there that could potentially, you know, create a complete picture that looks rosy and looks good enough where it's not as prone to manipulation as it is right now.
Cool. Perfect. Yeah, I think that makes sense. I think that's it from my barrage of questions.
let's wrap this up. So Vokkant, thank you so much for hopping on with us. Really appreciate your time, and thanks for, you know, giving us a schooling session. I learned a lot, at least. So thank you once again.
Yeah, thanks so much for jumping on. It was really, really
a lot of fun. And I love talking about technical things. So this was
same. I mean, like if you start me on this stuff, I'll never stop. So I think Sid has to hold me in check a little bit.
As soon as you said multi-blog MEV, I'm like, relax.
Yeah, you said multi-blog MEV, and I was like, okay, I can't. I've got to control myself.
Yeah. So anyway, thanks so much, and hopefully then maybe next time, if you can hop on, then we can talk about some MEV stuff as well.
Yeah, would be awesome to continue the chat.
Yeah, it was great, guys. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks, guys, tuning in for another episode of Genesis Block. Until next time. See ya.
See ya. Cheers. Bye. We'll be right back.